church here at Albemarle North Carolina this 19th Sunday after Pentecost. I invite you to join with me. For blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We will now have the lessons assigned for today.
A reading from Exodus. Down from the mountain. The people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us, who shall go before us? As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf, and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them. And of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains, and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join with me in saying the psalm appointed for today. Psalm 106. Hallelujah. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Who can declare the mighty acts of the Lord, or show forth all his praise? Happy are those who act with justice and always do what is right. Remember me, O Lord, with the favor that you have for your people, and visit me with your saving help, that I may see the prosperity of your elect and be glad with the gladness of your people, that I may glory with your inheritance. We have sinned as our forebears did. We have done wrong and dealt wickedly. Israel made a bull calf at Horeb and worshipped a molten image. And so they exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that feeds on grass. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt, wonderful deeds in the land of Ham, and fearful things at the Red Sea. So he would have destroyed them had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath from consuming them. A reading from Philippians. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Eudodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companions, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worth of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Once more Jesus spoke to the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. while the rest seized the slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. Now the king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. And then he said to his slaves, "The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets, invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet." Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so that the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man who was not wearing a wedding robe, and he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" He was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him out into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. You know, this was written by the Apostle Paul to the developing Christian community in Macedonia, in the city of Philippi, around AD 62. Paul knew these people from his visit there about 10 years prior, during his second missionary journey. Timothy had been with Paul then, and Paul was writing that Timothy would be coming back. The chance of Paul returning was slim because, most probably, he was imprisoned for that last time, the time that ultimately had him on his journey to Rome and ultimate execution. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy, my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, beloved. Philippi, the first Christian community in Europe, one of all Paul's communities for whom he held great affection because of their support of him in his missionary efforts. He knows all about their struggles, the opposition they had faced in the establishment of the community 10 years past, the opposition that they still faced. Still, his letter was filled with hope and optimism about what could be accomplished through Jesus. Now, Paul was not naively suggesting that all will be fine and dandy just because they became Christians. No, Paul is fully aware, teaches and preaches about what the costs are to live in faith in Christ crucified. I'll be back to Paul's letter, but just look at the bookends of the readings for the day for a moment. Both tell of people behaving badly. That great phrase from Judges, doing evil in the sight of the Lord. Let's start with the tale of Moses up on the mountain, listening to God and getting the Ten Commandments. We heard about those last week. And down in the valley, the escapees from Egyptian enslavement are grumbling and saying that the flesh pots back on the other side of the Red Sea were infinitely sweeter. The Egyptians had gods who were a lot nicer, a lot easier to deal with than this one that Moses wants us to follow. Ah, for Baal and the others who want us to dance and sing and eat and fool around. Now Aaron, Moses' brother no less, decides for some unknown reason to tell the folks for them to give to him all their jewelry, their golden jewelry, so he can melt it down and make a golden calf. Now, images of Baal were of a bull, so I would guess this is a variant of that, sort of Baal light, somewhat akin to present-day Christianity light, where some want the sweet but not the struggle, the power but not the humility, the control not the compassion, exclusion not the inclusion. Well, the desert wanderers got their golden calf. God told Moses what was going on and that there would be consequences. You know, that's in a voice that John Huston and Charlton Heston would have used on the film Ten Commandments. Moses convinces God to give the people another chance. After all, it was God who took them away from the flesh pots of Egypt with a plan to restore and to rebuild the relationship first established with Abraham. And in that wonderful understated sentence, and the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he had planned to bring to his people. Now, we can get all jumbled up about what type of God this Exodus God is. Remember, though, that it is the people, our ancestors, who wrote it down as they understood, not as God was. So what was this and the purpose of the story? Like all parts that make up this story about the people from going from Egypt to Canaan, they tell the story of a group becoming a people, a collection of families and persons becoming a people. In Egypt, they were enslaved, the descendants of the 12 sons of Jacob. They were the descendants of Joseph and his 11 brothers who had followed him into Egypt some 400 years before Moses. They'd lost their sense of who they were, what their call was. No longer were they people chosen by God to show others what it means to live faithfully in relation to God, not gods, plural. It was during their time in the desert with Moses that the people moved from being slaves to being Israelites. It's one of the bookends. The other bookend is from the Gospel of Matthew in the parable of the wedding banquet. Now, like all parables, it's intended to teach, to tell us about what it means to create and then to live in the kingdom of God, the realm of God, under the rule of God. Now, this parable is about responding to God's invitation to celebrate, to rejoice in the abundance that is of God. The invitation goes out from the king to join in the celebration of his son's marriage. Those invited joked about it and went on their own way, some to their farms, some to their businesses, a bit of Cain and Abel there. Others took hold of the king's messengers, mistreating some of them and murdering others. And the king responded in anger and destroyed the scoffers. A second group was invited and brought in to celebrate, and then there was that poor fellow who did not have the right clothes on, and he was tossed out. Now, for some of our fellow Christians, this means that only 144,000 will be saved. For others, you need to see Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, something that he did not ask of us. Sometimes we make things too complicated, for I'm inclined to say that this parable is more about the unconditional nature of God's grace, God's love for us, and our response through works. We're invited, and what we are to add will be our answer. Our answer, not singular, but plural. The call to community in Christ is not a first person singular, but first person plural. But back to Paul's letter. It has many parallels with the Exodus golden calf and Matthew's wedding banquet, but with a difference. The difference is that it's important because it is profoundly a reflection of what the good news of Jesus is about for us. In a certain sense, these two bookends are expressed in the negative, expressions of what people did wrong and what the terrible consequences could be or were. In a certain sense, they are the glasses half-empty stories. And both of them make me cringe. I'll make no bones about that. Both of them are about men and women getting it wrong because they were thinking only of themselves, about what they no longer had, about what they did not want to do. Paul's response is very different. Paul probably knows well what waits for him at the other end of his imprisonment. Still, he does not see as a failure of not getting it right. Far from it. Even in the midst of all that is fateful about what is happening in his life, the ups and downs, the troubles and challenges that people in Philippi have faced, still the glass is at least half full. At a minimum, half full. At best, on its way to be filled with more and more. So what does he tell his people, these Philippine kindred do? Not as individuals, but as a community called together in Christ. To rejoice always. To rejoice in the Lord always. To rejoice and let your gentleness be known to everyone. Not to worry about anything. Let your requests be known to God by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And finally, that wonderful expression, finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about those things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will always be with you. Are you thinking about what will happen here at Christ Church? Are you wondering what the next chapter will be like? You know what the leadership of the wardens, vestry, and priests explore for our future? Now here we have a blueprint for what a faithful and healthy community called together in Christ looks like. A community that is not struck on what used to be, you know, whatever Christ Church's version might have been of flesh pots and golden calves. Neither a community that does not understand that God's grace and invitation of unconditional love is for all of God's children. We are invited. We are the servants who carry out the invitations. We are the ones who make welcome. It is not about what I want or you want. It's about what we are called to do, whom we are called to be. Yes, the glass has been less than full in these last times past, but this is not true now. So let us celebrate, engage, support, make happen, invite, welcome, rejoice, pray, be not afraid, and give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Amen.
To do your will in all that we undertake.
That our words may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Okay, the prayer. us faithfully, grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. The glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you, also with you. Amen. Service continues on page 361 of the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. It is, Lord, therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. And he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.